Welcome back, everybody. Let's continue to talk about hypothesis testing. So far, we've gone through two examples, and both of those examples have been two-tail tests. In this example, let's do a one-tail test. When we do a one-tail test, the entire alpha level, in this case, that entire 5%, is all within just one side of the sampling distribution. Let's switch views, and we'll do this example together. All right, let's see what we have here. It says a researcher believes that a training program helps antisocial men better adjust to society. And when we're talking about these antisocial men, have in your mind people who are just returning from prison, for example. In the population of antisocial men, let's just assume that the population mean is 50 and the standard deviation is 10 on some standard measure of social adjustment. Let's assume something else as well. Let's assume that these guys are as low as you can get on that measure. 50 is kind of the bottom of the scale. She selects a sample of 25 to receive training. After training, the average score of the sample is 56. So it looks like potentially there was some type of an improvement. 56, that actual value, does differ from 50. But remember, like always, we're in the exact same situation. We have two good explanations for those results. One explanation is that that training works, and it does make these guys somewhat less antisocial or more social. Another explanation for those differences that we see is just sampling error, and it could be that this treatment has no effect at all. Does the training have a significant effect on social adjustment? Test with an alpha of 0.05, one-tailed. In this example, we're going to get some experience doing a one-tail test. One-tail tests are much more rare. Maybe 5% of the tests that I see out there published in journal articles are one-tail tests. For our class, we decided that if your results, theoretically speaking, could go in either direction, you should do a two-tail test. In this situation, I told you, these guys were about as low as you can get when it comes to social adjustment. They can't get any less socially adjusted. If they're going to move in any direction at all, it will be an improvement. So do you see how in this situation, it seems justified that we would do a one-tail test? Well, that logic makes sense to me. So let's do a one-tail test. In step one, we always state our hypotheses. And remember, we always state those hypotheses in terms of population parameters, mu. We're going to have a null hypothesis and an alternative hypothesis. The null hypothesis always states no effect, no differences. And the alternative hypothesis states the opposite, that there is some type of an effect. When we do one-tailed tests, I usually find it's easier to work on the alternative hypothesis first because it's more straightforward. Let's take a minute to label up these means first, just to remind ourselves what we're dealing with. Remember, we're not hypothesizing about the population mean social adjustment score for antisocial men. We already know that that equals 50. What we're hypothesizing about is the population mean social adjustment score for antisocial men who have been through this training. So the first question I ask myself is, mu what? Mean what? What am I measuring? I'm measuring social adjustment. I'm just going to abbreviate that with an ADJ for adjustment. And then I ask myself, adjustment for whom? We're trying to figure out the population mean adjustment score for the men who have been trained. So I'm going to put down /t/t. So I'm trying to learn about the population mean social adjustment score for the men who have been through training. We will learn about that population mean value from these 25 men in the sample who went through training. Well, as I stated, when we do these one-tailed tests, it's actually a little bit easier to first focus on the alternative hypothesis. It says in the description that higher scores represent greater adjustment. And of course, we're hoping that this treatment will result in better adjustment. So if there are differences, and we're doing this one-tailed test, what we're predicting is that the population mean social adjustment score for the treated people will be greater than 50. I think that's pretty straightforward. Now it's easier to see what we need to list for the null hypothesis, because the null hypothesis needs to include everything else. So in this case, the null hypothesis would state that the population mean social adjustment score for the men who have gone through training is less than or equal to 50. Based on what we said before, I guess it's theoretically possible that their scores can't even be less than 50. That's why some people write the null hypothesis as the population mean adjustment score for the treated people is equal to 50. There's not complete agreement on the most appropriate way to do it. I think that first way is the most appropriate way to do it, and that's what we're going to do in class. So again, we have two competing hypotheses. The null hypothesis essentially states the treatment doesn't work, and the alternative states that the treatment does work and it results in better social adjustment. All right, let's move on to step two. Remember, step two is all about figuring out how much evidence do we need to reject the null hypothesis. And what we like to do first is label up that distribution. We're dealing with, of course, a distribution of sample means. So right here on this x-axis, we are plotting sample means. We're going to create this distribution of sample means based on these population parameters right there. So we'll just kind of connect them to that distribution so we don't forget. And those parameters from the parent population tell us a lot about how that distribution of sample means will look. For example, the mean of this distribution of sample means, which we find right in the middle, will equal 50. We know that there's some variability in this distribution, and that's measured by the standard error of the mean. The variability in that distribution is influenced by two primary factors: the standard deviation from that parent population, so in other words, the standard deviation of their social adjustment scores, and then also the sample size. We need to divide by the square root of n. The standard deviation in this case is 10, and our sample size is 25. So we're left with 10 divided by 5, which equals 2. So on average, these sample means differ from 50 by about 2 points on that social adjustment scale. Let's remind ourselves of a couple other things. We create this distribution of sample means based on that null hypothesis being true. And then we're also going to have to list some z-scores. So we'll list z right underneath the sample means. So for example, that population mean value of 50, that would transform into a z-value of 0. All right, now let's remember why we're here at step two. We're trying to find the critical region or critical regions. In this case, we're doing a one-tailed test. We're doing a one-tailed test with an alpha of 0.05. What we need to do is put all 5% into that one tail. All that we will have is one rejection zone. Keep in mind, for this alternative hypothesis, we stated that the population mean adjustment score for the men who have been trained is greater than 50. That's why I put this critical region, this one rejection zone, on the right side of the distribution, because it's on the right side of the distribution that we see sample means greater than 50. When we did a two-tail test, we took that 5% and we split it between two tails. But now we're going to take that 5% and stick it all within that one tail. So next, we need to find what z-score marks off that distribution where it shows 5% in the tail. Let's take a look. Here's our z-distribution. I want to find 5% in the tail. So I'm going to look for the closest thing to 0.05. The closest thing in this column to 0.05. Passed it. Oh, here we go. Over here on this side, look, I see 0.0505 and I see 0.0495. Do you see how this value and this value are both equally far away from 0.05? They're both off by 5/10,000. So I need to pick between using a z-score of 1.64 or a z-score of 1.65. And in our class, we will always make this decision the same way when we're in this situation. We will always pick the z-score that pushes that critical region out just a little bit further. We're always going to pick the z-score that requires just a little bit more evidence. So let's pick this z-value of 1.65. So let's mark off 1.65. That's how much evidence we need to reject the null hypothesis. If step two is all about figuring out how much evidence we need, then step three is all about figuring out how much evidence we have. Because in step three, we're going to be able to figure out where exactly is 56. Once we transform 56 into a z-score, we'll be able to figure out, is 56 around here, meaning it's one of these sample means that's likely to occur just due to sampling error? Or is 56 in here, in the critical region, among the sample means that are unlikely to occur just due to sampling error? So let's go ahead and do that. Let's figure out where is 56. In that Z formula, we're going to stick in 56 for X bar, and then we're going to subtract the population mean of 50. Remember, that's always the value that we see listed in that null hypothesis. We're going to divide that by our standard error, which equals 2. So we have differences that we actually observe of 6 points divided by differences that we would expect just by chance of 2 points. That gives us a Z value of 3. And you probably recall that Z values of 3 are relatively large. So let's figure out where that Z value of 3 is. Right here in the middle, we have a Z value of 0. Here we have a Z value of 1.65. A Z value of 3 is clearly inside this critical region. It's inside this rejection zone. So let's just estimate that a Z value of 3 is right there. And I'm going to draw an arrow to it. We are inside the rejection zone. That z-score of 3 represents our sample mean of 56. So right above it, I'll put x bar equals 56. We are clearly in the rejection zone. And that's what we need to know for that first critical question that I'm going to ask. Is our sample mean inside the rejection zone? And the answer is yes. Now, the three follow-up questions that I'm going to ask, they will all be answered yes also. Here's the first follow-up question. Should we reject the null hypothesis? Yes, we should. So let's cross it out. We're going to reject the null hypothesis and embrace the alternative. Let's take a look at what that alternative says. It says the population mean adjustment score for the men who went through training is greater than 50. In other words, we have found that the training works. It improves their social adjustment score. So that's exciting. We found enough evidence to say the training works. The next follow-up question is, do we have statistically significant results? And the answer is yes. So we'll just jot down a little note to ourselves. And the final follow-up question is it possible, is it at least possible, that in this situation we are making a type 1 error? And again, the answer is yes, it is possible. Well, what is the probability that we're making a type 1 error? The probability over the long run that we're making a type 1 error is 5%, because our alpha level is 5%. Keep in mind, the sample means in that area are unlikely to occur by chance, but they do occur about 5% of the time just by chance. So it's at least possible that we just found that sample mean of 56 due to sampling error. It is possible that this treatment does not work at all. But remember, we need to be reasonable. At some point, we need to say we have enough evidence. And at some point, we drew that line. We drew that line where there are 5% of the most extreme sample means, and we just found a mean that is one of the most extreme. So this is like finding someone's fingerprints at the crime scene. This is like seeing a video of them committing a crime. It's very unlikely that we would find that data just due to chance. It's unlikely that we would find that data due to sampling error. So indeed, we conclude that we have statistically significant results. We conclude that we have sufficient evidence to say this treatment works. We have almost everything we need to start writing up our results in step 4. But there's one more thing that I'd like to talk about right at this point. At some point, we need to make a decision about the probability of finding our results just due to chance. And we're going to need to decide, is the probability of finding our results just due to sampling error less than 5%? Or is the probability of finding our results just due to sampling error greater than 5%? I'm going to remind you that our z-score was equal to 3. Our z-score was located right here in this small little tail. Area equals probability. We found our sample mean in that small area. So which is a small probability? A probability less than 5% or a probability greater than 5%? A small area should be associated with a small probability, and a small probability is p less than 5%. That's important because when people are reading our research results, when they see z equals 3, p less than 0.05, they know that that signifies a statistically significant result. Let's go ahead and write it up. Remember, there are four things that we need to cover in step four. You need to tell me if you're going to reject or fail to reject the null hypothesis. You need to tell me in everyday language what you found. You need to show me how your results would appear in a journal article. And you need to compute the most appropriate measurement of effect size, which in this case is Cohen's D. So let's address that first point. Yes, we rejected the null hypothesis. And here's the way that I would put that in context. I would say that our sample mean, 56, was within the critical region. This mean is unlikely to occur if the null hypothesis is true, so we reject the null hypothesis. Do you see how our data is inconsistent with the null hypothesis? That's why we reject the null hypothesis. In everyday language, what did we find? We found that training statistically significantly improved social adjustment. There are lots of different ways that you can write that statement. As long as we're all telling the same story without any bias, then we're on the right track. How would this result appear in a journal article? When we summarize the results of this z-test, we can see here that we found z equals 3. So over here we would write z equals 3. The probability of finding that result just by chance is less than 5%, and that is based on a one-tailed test. The last thing that we want to do is compute a measurement of effect size. It's one thing to say that this training works. It's another thing to give people an idea of how well it works. You might say, well, it improved their scores by 6 points. But what does that mean to me? I'm not real familiar with this social adjustment scale. Is 6 points a lot? Is that good? So it makes sense to compute a standardized measurement of effect size because that's going to tell me how much the scores improved in standard deviation units. So in the numerator, we took our sample mean of 56 and we subtracted that population mean of 50. So we found a difference of 6 points. And then we're simply dividing that by our standard deviation. And right up here, you can see the standard deviation on that measure of social adjustment is 10 points. 6 divided by 10 points equals 0.60. What that tells us is that these men improved in their social adjustment by 6/10 of a standard deviation. That's getting to be a medium to large effect size. That's not something that's trivial. Remember I told you that one way we can start making sense of effect sizes is by comparing them to IQ scores? A Cohen's D value of 0.6 means that there's a difference of 6/10 of a standard deviation. Remember, when it comes to IQ scores, one standard deviation is 16 points. Let's find 6/10 of that. So I'll multiply 16 times 0.6, and that equals 9.6. Let's just round that to 10 for right now. What we're saying is that the difference we found with this training is equivalent to a 10-point increase in IQ points. I don't know about you, but I'd love to have another 10 points added to my IQ. In fact, if I was dealing with a room full of people who had an average IQ of 100, and then I walked into another room and their average IQ was 110, I would almost certainly be able to tell that difference. So do you see how that Cohen's D measurement of effect size provides us with a lot of information above and beyond simply knowing that we found a statistically significant result? Well, that's enough for right now, my friends. We have one more example and we'll do that in the next video. In that example, we'll play around with using a different alpha level. I'll see you in that next video. In the meantime, be safe.